I tend to focus on SETI and exoplanet habitability as one of the mainstays of this channel, often exploring planets around small dwarf stars that have a chance of being able to sustain life on their planets. But there are also stars that are nothing close to suitable, and this is an exploration of those and why they are more or less ruled out for life. It pays to take a moment to look at how stars are classed. They are arranged and categorized on this chart called the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, named after the scientists that devised it over 100 years ago. The sort of wavy line going through the center is the main sequence, where our Sun currently sits, as do other type M, K, and G stars that are also thought to be possibly suitable for life. Outside this, you get the giant stars towards the top and the white dwarfs clustering at the bottom. The giant stars include stars like red giants. Our own Sun will become one of these when it leaves the main sequence, but the problem with red giants is that they are stars that are at the end of their lives. If they had habitable planets before they entered this phase, those habitable planets would have been swallowed, ejected, or otherwise stripped of their life. While life may be possible on outer planets newly warmed by the red giant, and just about anything can be colonized by passing spacefaring civilizations, red giants do not seem to be well suited for complex life in their own right. Other types of giant stars are equally unsuitable. The blue giants die young as they burn through their fuel at a much faster rate than a star like the Sun. In this case, there is simply not enough time for these stars to form planets and then life. And even if it did, after a few million years, these stars tend to go supernova. On the other side of the diagram are the white dwarfs, which are in essence only the remnants of stars. They are cooling cores, and any life that may have been present when it was still a normal star would likely be long gone due to the effects of the death of the star. In fact, it may even be worse than that. A significant portion of white dwarfs exhibit heavy metals. These metals, under normal circumstances, should not be visible and should sink down deep into the white dwarf. But there is a case of a white dwarf called WD1145+017 that appears to be vaporizing a minor planet that migrated inward after the dwarf was formed, suggesting that these metals seen in white dwarfs are the remnants of their former planets as materials from them fall into the star. At the same time, however, it may be possible for a new habitable zone to form around a white dwarf due to planetary migration. If a planet manages to survive the process that created the white dwarf, and then manage to migrate inward into the new habitable zone, life may still be able to arise. And then there is the main sequence itself. Similar problems befall most stars on the sequence above the Sun's class as a type G dwarf star. Type O stars, for example, emit extremely high levels of ultraviolet radiation, which may not even allow them to form planets, much less spawn life. And again, most of the stars above type F just don't last long enough for life to arise. But F-type stars, along with G, K, and M, do last long enough. F-type stars may emit too much ultraviolet for surface life, but the ice shell moon or planet possibility might come into play here. Likewise, we know that G-type stars, at least some of them, can be quite good for life. After all, the Sun is one of them. And finally, the orange dwarf stars might be even better for life than our Sun is. It's worth noting that these types of stars make up between 5 to 10% of the galaxy, opening up plenty of chances for life. But the most numerous and long-lived kind of star in this galaxy, the type M red dwarfs, may or may not be suitable for life other than ice shell scenarios. The problem with these stars is that their habitable zones are very close into the star, which creates a lot of problems for surface life. There's the ultraviolet light problem due to proximity, along with tidal locking, and at least some red dwarfs can experience violent flaring and outbursts. But as we see with Earth, life is tenacious, and whenever it can find a way to cling on, it tends to. But if you have technology, almost anything can be colonized, so I wonder if it might be a bit premature to write off stars outside of what we think could have habitable zones as SETI targets. After all, if you're going to construct a huge radio beacon and have it blast out messages for several million years, a bigger, more powerful star might fit the bill better as an energy source than a dwarf star might. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Gaudier, currently wishing SpaceX good luck as they move closer to launching Falcon Heavy and the Tesla Roadster playing Space Oddity on its radio. I figure that if aliens ever pass through the solar system and find it, they'll either be confused and wonder why we would launch that, or in a billion years, the galaxy will resonate to David Bowie's greatest hits as performed by Glorkon and the Screeching Xenomorphs. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.